mentioning that that's what they decide. So I anticipate that we'll have more questions at the dinner time pertaining particularly to critiques, and I want to set that up for us intellectually. That is a question of my own, which I'd be interested in having you respond to immediately or as the evening wears on. Obviously, you have a lot of arguments to marshal in favor of what NAFTA stands for and what it's accomplished. But also, obviously, there are some people in office and around this country who have real, genuine concerns. What would you say is the most meaningful critique that has been made of NAFTA, and why it's appropriate for people to have concern about NAFTA in that respect? There's a lot to support NAFTA, as you show. What, when people get concerned about NAFTA, are they correct in being concerned about?
I think you'll see in any trade agreement, any evolution of an economy, that there will be winners and losers. No one hides that. And usually it turns out that the benefits of broadening spread and the costs are more narrowly focused. And I think that all three governments need to be doing a better job at helping those who are being hurt by changes, whether it's through NAFTA or the coal industry, move away from coal. There are people who are hurt and suffer, so governments can help them around. It's not just because it's the right thing to do, because they're good citizens and pay the dues, it's also because this is right for the society as a whole to help them become. People who lose jobs, it's tough on the person who loses a job, tough on the family, tough on the society. And we need to be more open to helping and find more and better and imaginative ways to do so.
Yeah, basically, in line with that, NAFTA is now going to be that the union is only. Policy, it's not the cause of all the evils and not the cause of all good results in the economy. I mean, you have to complement that those negotiations with government policies to help those sectors suffering from liberalization to adjust and also to improve the ability of those who are really and fully benefit from that decision. Now, in terms of what NAFTA can do, it's very valid comments and problems internally that the country faces whenever they engage in free trade. I think there are many options, many areas of improvement in the NAFTA. It's a very old agreement, and we have learned a lot of things from the different chapters and from these years. Investment, for instance, there's a critique internationally, and that has gone to the European also that these type of provisions protect big multinational companies that can go to a country establish and pollute rivers and cause harm and just leave whenever they want without giving any benefit to the they are established. That's a critique that is at the moment whenever there is a panel. The panelists, which is a small club, basically side in favor of this investment and not in favor of the state, which is trying to propose legitimate public policies. So there are things, and Mexico was participating in the negotiation with that approach, trying to improve this mechanism. An example, trying to put this mechanism to make it more accessible to all investors, not only to the investors, trying to make these processes more transparent in terms of how to choose panelists and how to assess the decision of these panels. And this is just an example of how these versions can be. I mean, if you go chapter by chapter, you can actually will find a lot of areas of opportunity to improve the provisions and address what is in the
So the modernization process is ongoing currently. It's been going on for almost a year. So any projected will be over by the end of this year or somewhere close to that. Is that the time frame you would expect for this kind of update? And as we progress further as a society and have to update this more, is that the kind of time frame that we expect to continue throughout? Is this time frame efficient to actually adapt to the changing society?
I think we are going to do different topics here. One is the time frame for the negotiation. I think every negotiation is different in what it takes. I mean, some negotiations take 4 rounds, other negotiations take 15 years. The negotiation, I think, we decided intentionally not to have a deadline for the conclusion of this negotiation. Originally, there was the intention to conclude as soon as possible. It was a very tight schedule of 7 rounds at the beginning of the process in August. And it proved to be not the most efficient way to proceed because we had very close, very little time to consult, to go back to our consultants and consult on the positions of the conference. So now we have clarity in this, and we will conclude whenever we have a good agreement. We prefer a good agreement than an agreement at any cost. And if it takes longer, well, that's going to be the case. And secondly, how the results of an agreement can be reviewed, and we don't have to wait 24 years to start adapting the provisions to the rapidly changing environment, economic environment. I think one of the good results of that proposal is precisely the fact that we have now at the table a proposal to review NAFTA every X number of years with clear criteria to review the results, and also with the instruction to provide recommendations on after that review in order not to wait or not to conclude the agreement to make changes that are necessary to change the environment.
I'll just note that I was sent off to Geneva in the fourth year of the Uruguay round of negotiations to be there for the final 3 months. I did the final 3 months of the negotiations 4 years running, and rather somewhat by accident, we concluded a 4 year negotiations at the year 8. Now, and the next round is supposed to take 4 years, and it's been going on 15? Yeah. But this one, there's a focus. We already have an agreement to start with. We're looking at every single chapter. We start with a good base to figure out what we need to change. All three countries have put forward proposals. Not all at the same level of approval, but we've got something to work from. And I think it's not so much the negotiating process, which does take time and does require you to consult broadly, get your legal opinions. Does this work? Does it not? What are the implications of doing this? But you add to it the legal issues, the political issues, and various elections. And you've just got a much more complicated issue. Plus, you throw in the US approval process that requires significant advance notice that you would come to an agreement before you finally vote on. We're willing to take the time necessary to get a good agreement, but we also respect that there are needs in our trading partners on how quickly they perhaps still are getting information given what's happening domestically. Try doing that with the 152 plus members of the WTO, we can never find a gate that works for anybody. For all 152 of us, we're looking to make the epidemic. So I think if we can do it quickly, great. If it takes a few more months, great. We will find a solution that works for all of us. But we also have to find something that each country can go back and say, we've got this, we've got this, we've got this.
Okay, well, I was told by Captain Leschek that I need to wrap this up right around 6:05 because there's another group coming in here, and it is 6:05. So, for those of you who are joining us over across the street for dinner, I look forward to seeing you. And for those who are not, thank you for coming. And I would ask you to all just join together and thank our guests for their wonderful time.